And that's a great prayer for us, save in every sense of the word. Hosanna, praise the Lamb of God.
Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Lord, we lift up your name with hearts full of praise. Be exalted, O Lord, my God, Hosanna in the highest.
Glory, glory, glory to the King of Kings. Glory, glory, glory to the King of Kings. Lord, we lift up your name with hearts full of praise. Be exalted, O Lord, my God, glory to the King of Kings. Lord, we lift up your name with hearts full of praise.
Important today as it was then. Dudley, would you come forward and open us in prayer, please, as we go before the throne. Thank you, Jesus. I see you're sporting your handsome sweatshirt there with the Reach Out logo. Free advertising.
Oh, Lord, we just bless you and thank you for the opportunity to come into your presence together and offer praise and worship to you. Lord, we thank you. We ask that you would give the pastors wisdom as they bring forth your word, and that your word would take root and lodging in our hearts. We bless you and thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen and amen. We're going to worship the Lord. You may stand or sit, whatever's comfortable for you. And we start the week off right with our eyes on Jesus. Amen. And we're getting ready for Easter next Sunday, so we're going to get some hymns in that vein, which will get us in the mood.
Amen.
I'm always in the mood for celebrating the resurrection of the Lord, aren't you? Oh, lead me to Calvary.
Of my life I crown thee now, thine shall the glory be. Lest I forget thy thorn-crowned brow, lead me to Calvary. Lest I forget Gethsemane, lest I forget thine thine agony. like Mary through the gloom. Come with a gift to thee. Show to me now the empty tomb. Lead me to Calvary. Lest I forget Gethsemane. Lest I forget thine agony. Lest I forget thy love for me. Lead me to Calvary. May I be willing, Lord, to bear daily my cross for thee. Even thy cup of grief to share, thou hast borne all for me. Lest I forget Gethsemane, lest I forget thine agony, lest I forget thy love for me, lead me to Calvary, lead me to Calvary.
That's where our lives really began, at Calvary. Lead me to Calvary. Well, the good news is that he's no longer there. He has arisen. Hallelujah.
Coming day, Jesus my Lord. Up from the grave he arose, with a mighty triumph for his foes. He arose a victor from the dark domain,
and he lives forever with the saints to reign.
He arose, he arose, hallelujah.
Savior.
And where are your loved ones? If they knew the Lord Jesus, they're waiting for you.
Amen. They're with him now. Oh, he lives.
I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. I know that he is living, whatever men may say. I see his hand of mercy. I
along life's narrow way. He lives, he lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives. He lives within my heart. In all the world around me, I see his loving care. Though my heart grows weary, I never will despair. I know that he is leading through all the stormy blasts. The day of his appearing will come at last. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. How I know he lives within my heart.
Your voice
rejoice, O Christian, lift up your voice and sing. Eternal hallelujahs to Jesus Christ the King, the hope of all who seek him, the help of all who find. No other is so loving, so good and along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives within my heart. Amen.
He lives within my heart. Amen. Glory
Hallelujah.
To his name.
Savior died, down where for cleansing from sin I cried, there to my heart was the blood applied, glory to his name, glory to his name, glory to his name, there to my heart was the
Precious God.
seated. Glory to his name. Thank you, Jesus. Let's go into prayer, shall we? Kelly's going to lead us.
Yes. Oh, gracious Father, we are grateful, Lord, for bringing us here tonight through the storm and keeping us safe, Lord, through the night and bringing us here safely. We thank you and we give you all the glory and honor. Lord, we thank you for your traveling mercies. We pray for those who may still be traveling to come here, Lord. We pray that you would bless them and bring them here safely. And we ask for all those who may have missed today, Lord, that they would be able to watch now or later and the service, and that they would be encouraged, Lord. We ask you to bless each person, Lord, who's come, those who are working and those who are watching or later will be watching. Bless them, Lord, and just sustain. We ask for your sustenance, Lord, for you to provide all that they need. We pray that everything we do and say today would glorify you. We ask for your Holy Spirit not only to be with us, we know that your Holy Spirit is with us, but we're asking for the Holy Spirit to come and to bring power here, Lord.
Yes,
we
Lord.
Welcome you, Holy Spirit, and we ask for you to come with power. We glorify your name, Jesus. We glorify you, Holy Spirit. We worship you, Holy Spirit, and we welcome you here, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Amen and amen.
Amen and amen. Well, this is the time we take our tithes and offerings and alms and offer them before the Lord. Even as Hebrews tells us, the Lord is offering them before the throne of God. And Ixie, I'm going to ask you, is Ixie here? I just saw him.
He is.
If you'll join Ben in the back, if you guys will bring the collection plates up. And Pastor Tyrlin Burke is with us. Ty, come on up if you would and offer the prayer of thanksgiving. Tyrlin was our worship leader for many years, most beautiful bass voice, most faithful, loyal guy I ever knew in my life. And he has his own church now, and he's going to tell you about that just for a moment. And it's the name of the church is The Way.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. All right. Good morning, brothers and sisters. Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you all, my brothers and sisters, for being here with us to serve and worship the Lord Jesus Christ.
Put you right here if you want, and we'll offer up this prayer. Ixie, come on up, sir. This is his son, Ixie, professional diver and handsome guy, and a smart student, too. And you all know Ben, who's our faithful man for collections as well. So let's offer the prayer of thanksgiving, shall we?
Lord, we come before you always and only in the name of Jesus. We thank you for even the snow, the ice on a planet, which, thank you, works right.
Thank you, Father.
We thank you for having seasons. If we didn't have a winter, we wouldn't have a summer. We thank you for the love, the mercy, the grace that you have shown us, that mercy which by definition is undeserved, that you gave to us through the death of your own and only Son. Few of us have our parents, few of us have children, and I don't know that I could do that, but you did.
Amen.
I thank you for loving us all this much. You have done so such that we could serve you. You have given, in this case, your tithes, your offerings, your alms, with the purpose of them being used towards your kingdom. Thank you for allowing us to return these to you. May you be blessed by us. May your joy be fulfilled in us, that as it was in Jesus, who lives in our heart, for your glory, in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Let's also, Kelly, lay hands on Ty, if we will, for this new ministry called The Way.
Oh, yeah.
And he and Ixie are starting a church in this area, if you guys would join us in prayer. Father, we thank you for Tyrlin and for Ixie. They have been faithful. Ixie grew up in this church as a very small little boy and now is a fine young man. Tyrlin's been with us through thick and through thin, through storms and sunny days. When there was problems, he stood with us. He is a man of loyalty and faithfully. He has always stood by you and by those who profess your name. And now, Lord, you've called this man to go forth with his son and with his dear mother and others to plow some new territory, some new fields. There's always room for another good work. And we pray for The Way, we pray for Tyrlin, pray for Ixie, pray for Rosetta, and for all who will be a part of this fellowship. We pray, Lord, that it's going to be one that's going to honor you and bless you, be faithful to the teaching of your word and bringing people to Christ. Bless Tyrlin now as he has about five different hats he wears, including working for the state and being a union leader and all kinds of things. He's got a lot on his plate. Be with him, strengthen him, encourage him in Jesus' name, and help Ixie, Lord, to do well and get back into diving and be the champion he is and to do well with his studies as he goes on to RPI. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen.
I think, Ben, you went to RPI, didn't you?
My last semester is right now.
So you are on your last semester at RPI, and Ixie is going to be going back there again. So why don't you guys do some RPI talk?
Sorry.
The engineer cheers or whatever you guys do, okay? All right, thank you all. Two RPI guys, you can't do better than that, can you? Huh?
Very exciting, huh?
All right, well, we're going to get some testimonies. Frances, if you're looking lovely as always, I just love to see the outfits that she wears on Sundays.
Yes.
Always got something exciting
Amen.
To wear. And beautiful pink. Dress for the Lord. You don't dress for me. You dress for Jesus, don't you? Let's have some testimonies and prayer requests. Peter's got his hand raised up there, and then Tyrelyn.
It's mixed. It's both. I pray for Casey. He went to urgent care for bronchitis yesterday. But also a prayer of thanks that his mom reached out to me and asked for a ride. Baby steps, as Pastor said.
Can we have first name on her?
Jennifer.
Jennifer, all right. Let's pray for Jennifer. Yeah, baby steps. We're looking for healing. Okay, good. And Tyrelyn's got something to share, I think, here. So, good morning. Hi, how are you?
Sorry for late.
You look familiar. Good to see you, dear. I know, Judy. Good to see you.
Judy, good to
Kelly
see you.
Kelly is such a big fan of yours.
I love Judy.
Judy's got all kinds of stuff she passes out. So if you have a big pocketbook, you're still passing stuff out the way you used to at Full Gospel. She used to have, we had more tracks she would pass out.
And
she's always got a pocketbook.
Judy, yeah. Dr. Quinlan's wife.
That's right.
He was a great
Tim.
Man.
Tim went home to be with Jesus recently, and Tim was... Yeah,
and I still have a lot of your things.
Oh, she thinks the world of you, Judy. Good to see you. And
what a
Tony,
blessing.
Thanks for bringing her.
What a blessing.
Did you bring Tony or Joe, or did Joe bring you? good to see you.
How are you?
Ireland, yes, sir.
My husband went to be with the Lord.
I know
I
he
know
did.
It. Tim was wonderful. I'm looking forward to seeing him. Yeah.
Good morning, brothers and sisters. Again, real quick, someone wants to finish this for me. I'm not sure whom. The Lord said unto my Lord, sit at my right hand until, anybody, Bueller? Exactly right, ladies. Wonderful ladies, thank you. Blah, 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 I'm the president of my union. There was a lady there who liked to badmouth me. She would tell all my coworkers how I didn't know what I was talking about. The information I gave out was wrong. And one time she literally directly, while off meds, threatened to kill me. I mean that directly. She said if I spoke to her in a certain way again, she was going to literally kill me. Well, the Lord kindly reminded her that he had put me there for a reason. She ended up in a great deal of trouble. Mm. And praise the Lord, I was the representative that she knew was the only person there qualified to do the saving.
Wow.
So she's not, I'm not going to mention any whatever, and I would ask that we pray for her. Because the Lord's word is bless those who curse you. Pray for those who spitefully.
Yes. What's her first name or initials?
Yeah. You know what? Would we just can we go with just the coworker, please? Just
Tyrelyn's co. Yeah, absolutely.
Please, because that's it's confidential.
Oh no, I get it.
Thank you. Anyway, so we were at what's called an interrogation where the state's allowed to beat you up, and she actually had a good time. Having a good time at my expense being her defender. But that said, I did defend her professionally as mm-hmm. appropriate with the Lord, and the Lord reminded her about all those nasty things that she said to me and how she was there with me helping her out anyway. And the Lord keeps his word.
That's right. He
the
does.
The Lord keeps his word. If you're getting beaten up,
you got to be obedient to him, and then he brings it forth. He's very
Absolutely.
Faithful.
I've been beaten up. I don't mm-hmm. want to tell you that I've had it worse than you. That's not what I'm saying. But I have been there. I have done that. And when the Lord brings you through, it's a beautiful feeling. Thank the Lord.
Tyrelyn represented his enemy. Last night I was texting my grandson, Ryan. You want to know why I was here so late? And I explained your snow plowing and all that. And I said, I'm writing a letter for Tyrelyn. And his remark about you, sir, and I think I sent this to you, This is what young Ryan had to say about you. Good for him. Glad he's doing well. He has a good heart. And that summarizes you. So we all say amen to that. Who else has a word to share? Yes, hi, Sally.
Hi, good morning. I just want to praise God that he's had his hand on us through the storm, this ice storm on this area, on the capital region. And I just wanted to praise him that he's helping people get through this.
Amen.
I know I didn't have power when I got home after prayer yesterday, but the house was still warm, and then nightfall came quickly, and then I just slept through it.
Good for you.
I didn't know what time the power went on. So I praise God for that, and I just pray that other people, Lord, you will restore their power quickly to Lord God, and just send the help that this area needs, even if it's from other counties, to come out and help us. I noticed that they've been helping each other with the other companies and their trucks coming to help other people. I pray that the other counties will continue to help each other as the day tarries. Thank you.
Amen. Amen.
Francis, give the microphone to Diane right behind Sally. Diane has been a part of our fellowship, like so many, never set a foot inside this church until today. She's moved closer to us over at the promenade on Western Avenue, but she was nowhere near us geographically, but always with a radio program. And she was with us through All My Dogs, from JD on down, and been with us about 30 years. Diane, stand up and say hi. And she's not quite 20. She has the skin of a 20-year-old, but she's not quite 20. And she is the dearest lady. Just say hi to us.
I'm pretty old, but I thank the Lord he's brought me through these many years. And I used to listen to Jerry Lynn with my boys, listening also on the radio. In fact, we didn't watch TV. I like to listen to Christian radio all the time.
Wonderful.
But, you know, they heard Jerry Lynn, too, and it was when they were young boys in school, in the
Amen.
Christian school.
Amen.
I worked in the Christian school for wow. 6 years, and I thank the Lord they were able to go.
Wow.
But I praise the Lord for what we heard from Jerry. It encouraged me. He's a wonderful Bible teacher.
Amen.
Very, very gifted Bible teacher.
Sure is.
And his new wife is a good helper as well as a teacher herself.
Aww,
and God bless
is.
Them both. And I'm
thank
an animal
you.
Lover too.
Aww.
I used to work for a vet, and we had lots of animals. So
wow.
God bless
we attract the animal lovers.
And when you talk to Diane, she's going to just take a moment and say, now, would you pray for a woman across the street? There's one upstairs. There's a guy down the street. Somebody that I talked to. She'll have about 5 or 6 prayer requests. She
wow.
is a, she's
praise
a real
the Lord.
Intercessor like Francis. So they're going to spend the rest
Amen.
Of their days interceding for the Lord. I think Ashley has
nice
a hand
to
up.
Nice to meet you, Diane. Thank you so
Thanks
much.
Thanks for coming, Diane.
For your kind and encouraging words.
So my car's been having issues on and off. I got it fixed a couple months ago and wound up having like transmission and something else leaking. I needed a new radiator and all this stuff. And I had no money whatsoever. My boyfriend and one of my best friends from since I've been 16 decided, you know, they were gonna help me pay because I went for a CT scan that showed that I had a ruptured ovarian cyst. And I was freaking out as I'm waiting to go pick up my car thinking, I don't know if I can pay, you know, completely for this. So when I got there, my best friend paid for it all. He, I gave him the, had given them the money from my boyfriend, and he actually handed me money back and was like, I think you're gonna need this. And that was
yeah.
it.
Praise
and then
the
they
Lord.
Went to, he went back to do his gig at the firehouse.
Wow,
so,
praise the Lord, Ashley.
I was like, even though I was having a bad day with the cyst and everything, I was like, I thank God, I was grateful that
Amen.
It happened like that.
Amen, Ashley.
And I can give him my boyfriend back the money so I don't feel bad for borrowing money. So.
Yeah.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
I want to just take a moment and talk about faithfulness. I think about Diane, who's been with us for about 30-some-odd years, but I think about Judy, and I met Judy back in 1978 with Full Gospel Businessmen, and I'm just, these ladies and many of you as well have been faithful for the Lord day after day, year after year. I love instantaneous miracles, they're great, but for those who steadily every day, year after year, decade after decade serve the Lord, that's the faithfulness of God. And so Judy, thanks for hanging in there and being a great testimony. Diane, the same for you and all of you as well. When you know the Lord, he has you in his hand. You do not desert, you do not leave. And thank you for your faithfulness. You're an inspiration to all of us.
And you sprinkle salt around here.
Salt in a...
Think about all the things you're sprinkling. Judy, I know you couldn't get away with Judy and everyone in that whole place. What was the name of the place we used
to
go?
Full Gospel Businessman.
Where we have the breakfast.
Corral.
I miss those breakfasts. Yeah. They were so
you're
nice.
You're about to leave, and Judy gets a hold of you, and she gets the pocketbook
out. She'll get you, and she'll
get
you. She'll tell you a word the Lord has, and she'll give you something. You'll go home, and you'll look at it, and you're like,
so Judy, stand at the door.
God's talking to me.
On the way out, stand at the door. She's going to stuff your pockets full of tracks. I know she will. All right. Anybody else?
Yes.
Karen, in her beautiful pink, showing her Jamaican colors.
I love that color pink, Karen.
I just love pink.
Shocking.
I just want to thank the Lord. My cup runneth over.
Amen. Amen.
If I didn't know I was on earth, I would swear I was on another planet. It is so beautiful with those trees looking like crystal entities
really
out there.
Amen.
Yes. I was amazed all the way, and I kept thanking Jesus. Like, so thank you for this beautiful scenery, because
sure.
It's going to melt and go away.
Right.
Then it's going to be the flowers, the greens.
Amen.
I just love it.
It's all good.
That's
all
my
good.
Thank you
it's
for
a gift.
The Lord today.
It's still a
beautiful,
it's a beautiful gift.
Amen. Yes.
Even
Amen.
In the midst of this. It
All
really
right.
is.
Let's get into prayer. Wonderful testimonies.
All right. So we have a lot of testimonies. I don't know if you guys remember last week we prayed, and they're starting to do, they're working on a deal with the hostages again. So we can't forget those hostages, right? And we know that there's a lot of prisoners and there's a lot of going on in the war. I personally cannot forget my brothers and sisters that are suffering in Israel. So we need to remember, I don't know how many are left alive. We don't know if they're down to 80 pounds, if they're eating, what's going on. Try to remember those people. And God is doing something. If there's some alive, we want to see them brought out to their families and brought released. Keep praying for them. Keep praying that we can see an end to the war, the children, those little children that are being hurt and harmed. And we keep saying, just end the war, but what's going to happen to those people that are in prisons? They never, and they might die like that, right? There are people still alive. Whether you believe it or not, there's people suffering. So I'm asking that you would pray for the hostages and an end to that war. So we're going to pray for that. Also for free speech. Whether you believe what's going on in the medical company institution or not, I spent a lot of time, hours of day studying this stuff. There's a lot going on with medical freedom, with freedom of speech, and what we're hearing. You need to pray, no matter where you are, that we have a right to take what we want into our bodies, that we have a right to freedom of speech. We can say what we want, because if those things are taken away, and yesterday I was working at one of the hospitals, and I went to buy a sandwich, and I had cash, and I didn't know that, but the whole system does not allow cash anymore. That blew my mind. Blew my mind. I had no money. One of my students comes running over and they're like, Professor Lynn, you didn't know? And I'm like, no, I didn't know. They call me professor. Whatever. I'm like, no, I didn't know. They're like, oh, yeah. What, let us buy your lunch. And I'm like, okay. Oh, I owe them $8 for my lunch. I said, when did this happen? They are stopping cash. And you think it's like, oh, it's convenient. But this is moving forward. It's moving forward. It's a big system. It's not yours. Okay? It's not yours yet. And so I'm like, wow. So, I mean, we are just moving forward. We still have to be the voice of reason. And we're looking up for Jesus to take us home. You know, we're looking up. But the Bible predicted this 40 years ago, 50 years ago when I became a Christian. I remember these older Christians coming and telling me, one day they're going to ask you to take a mark. I'm like, yeah, right. One day you're not going to be able to use cash. Yeah, right. Okay? One day they're going to take over. We look back at Germany. What happened in Germany? Right? What happened in Germany? They used the medical system. You know, there's people that don't like me. They think I'm crazy. That's okay. That's fine. I've been reading my Bible a long time, and these things are starting to come to pass. So are we going to stop all of them? No, but we are going to give Jesus to people. Give them Jesus. I don't care if they're gay, binary, non-binary. I don't even know what these words. It doesn't matter. Give everybody Jesus and let Jesus work on their hearts, because we need to give Jesus Christ to the population, because that's what's going to get them to heaven. That's what saves. It's the blood of Christ. Let God deal with everything else. You can speak the truth. We need to speak the truth. But there's a lot of everybody's on that gay kick. I'm not saying it's not in the Bible, and I'm not saying anything, but give them Jesus, because when it all comes down, it's going to be about Jesus Christ. It's all going to be about him. All this stuff is moving forward, and every week I am so blown away. So keep the focus on Jesus. I really needed to say that. The Lord just works in me for these things. And so now I'm going to ask that you continue to pray. Look at your prayer book here. There's a lot of people on here that need prayer. All right, we need to pray for Anna Wireman. So, Father, we thank you and praise you, Lord. We give you all the glory and honor. We think of Anna Wireman, Lord. She has cancer in her lungs, bladder, and brain. Lord, you know what's wrong with her, Lord. We're asking for you to strengthen her. We're asking you to touch her body and heal her. And Lord, most of all, that your loving arms would be wrapped around her. If any of these people don't know you as their personal Savior, Lord, we're asking for a miracle. That the biggest miracle is coming to know Jesus Christ as our Lord and our Savior, the Son of God, who came down onto this earth, Lord, as a man, divine, part man. And died on the cross, shed his blood for us, and rose again. The Word of God says we need the blood, the covering. And Father, we thank you for the covering, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that the blood, as the Passover comes, Lord, as the blood covers the doors, as Moses used that blood to cover, Father, we pray for the blood to cover us. We thank you, Lord, for your blood. And Father, we ask for Jimmy, for prayer for Jimmy, for continued healing for him. He's a precious man, Lord. We ask you to touch him from the top of his head to the soles of his feet. May he be healed and may he be well and strengthened in you, Lord. We pray for Taryn that she would have healing from shingles, Lord. We ask you to touch her and heal her in the mighty name of Jesus, according to Isaiah 53. By your stripes, we believe for healing for her. We pray for Taryn's sister, Randy. Lord, we ask for complete healing of her hip. And we ask you to strengthen her body, Lord, and let no weapon formed against her prosper. We pray for Peter, for his family and friends, shalom, over the passing of his aunt. We pray, Father, that Casey would be healed from this bronchitis. We pray for Jennifer, healing between Casey and Peter in the mighty name of Jesus. We believe the Word of God is the truth. We believe, Lord, for healing. We believe for reconciliation. We know, Lord, that you are the great one who reconciles people one to another. We pray that Jennifer would flee from the snare of the evil one who's had her captive, Lord, and she would commit her life to you, bow her knee to you, and that, Lord, she would reconcile with her family, reconcile with Peter. There would be shalom, peace between all of them, Kirsten and Casey and every one of them, Lord. We ask for healing upon them. We pray for Tyrone's co-worker. Lord, we know that when a man's ways please the Lord, he makes even his enemies to be at peace with them. So we pray, Father, right now for Tyrone's co-worker. We pray that you would give her a softening in her heart. We pray that you would give Tyrone a spirit of forgiveness. We thank you for what he has done, as he's already forgiven and done so much. But whatever else needs to be done there, Lord, be with Tyrone. Help him to see the mighty hand of God and shalom peace in his life, and how you work out, Lord, that as he makes his ways peaceful to you and peaceful to others, you will take those enemies and you will disperse them and even blow them away like chaff in the wind. Lord, we thank you, Lord. We pray that they would be saved. We pray that they would be blessings would be upon his enemies, and we pray that they would do right, and we thank you and praise you for reconciliation and healing. We pray for the Alling family who lost their precious brother Jeff, their father Jeff. We ask you to touch and heal them. We ask you to strengthen them. We thank you, Lord, that Jeff knew you. He suffered much in his life, Lord, and we ask for your shalom peace upon his family. We thank you, Lord, for what you're going to do in his family. Bring those children to Christ, Lord, and we pray one day they'd see their father and their family member again. We thank you and praise you. We thank you for Jeff's sister who was mighty for you, Lord. We just ask you to bless shalom peace upon that family in Jesus' name. We pray for the hostages, Lord. We ask, Lord, for any and all of the hostages that are left alive, Lord, that you would release them into for their family. The bodies of those who have been passed, Lord, release them to their families, Lord, so that they can have closure, Lord. And we pray for an end to this ceasefire, to this war, Lord, and we ask for healing upon your people. We ask for deliverance from these those, the aggressors, Lord, and we ask for reconciliation, some kind of healing, Lord, in the mighty name of Jesus. We know that, Lord, time is winding down. It's not winding up, it's winding down as much as we can see. So, Father, we ask for free speech. We ask for free speech, medical speech. We ask for courageous men and women to stand up and stand against medical tyranny. We ask for courageous men and women. We ask you to bless the doctors, Lord. I thank you for so many of them, Dr. Cole, Dr. McCullough, so many who are out there fighting against all these problems, Lord, and showing the problems of everything, Lord, that has been happening in the last 4 years. We ask for healing upon your people who are suffering for long COVID, from vaccine injuries. We ask for healing upon your people. We ask for research, Lord. We pray that you would raise up mighty men and women of God who would bring forth research and treatments to help those who are suffering. And meanwhile, Lord, what we would bring forth the word of God, and that we would bring Jesus to your people. We pray for Herbie, Paul's brother. We thank you, Lord, that you spared his life. We ask for healing. We pray that Herbie would be able to come back to church. He used to go to church at Resurrection. We pray, Father, that Herbie would come to church when he is well, and he would give glory and honor to the Lord. We ask you to touch him from the top of his head to the soles of his feet. Touch Paul's brother, his sister-in-law, the whole family. May they know shalom, peace, and healing. And, Father, we pray for Sally was saying, we ask for the power to be restored to our area. We thank you, Lord. We ask for whatever. We know that it's probably many counties that are suffering. We don't have power ourselves. Throughout most of the house, have a little bit because we do have a small generator. We ask you to touch us, Lord, and touch the whole county and bring healing. Many people have refrigerators. They have food in the refrigerators and freezers. We ask you to repair and bring forth the power back to these counties here in New York, upstate New York, quickly. And we ask you to provide whatever is needed, the manpower, maybe from other counties. We thank you and praise you, Lord. We give you all the glory and honor. We love you, Jesus. We praise your holy name. And now bless your people, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
I got a call from Pastor Paul Anoboli, and they've done biopsies on the tumors on his pelvis, and they are benign, thank God, as well as the liver. And so he wants to thank you all for your prayers. It's a wonderful hand of God. We're so grateful for that. Next week is Easter, Resurrection Sunday, and we're going to try our new program as we do for Christmas. We're going to have readings and hymns about Easter, so it's going to be your chance to present the wonderful story of Jesus' resurrection. So if you'd like to sign up and do a reading, please do so today. I'll start working on the assignments this week. Come on in, if you would, about 10 minutes early next week, about 10:20, to get your assignment and make sure you have it in time, answer any questions you might have, and we'll start the program at 10:30, the Lord willing. And I think we're about set to get into our study, and we'll get the camera going for our television audience, and our Sunday school team will get together and have their program downstairs. And thank you all for your participation. Many, many young people have gone through that program, including Ben and Ixie, and we thank you all for your participation. Your teachers, you're just wonderful for doing that. This morning, let's take our Bibles and turn in the New Testament to the book of Revelation. Revelation chapter 13, the Satanic Trinity. How about that for a title? The Satanic Trinity, Revelation 13. We're going to look at Satan's imitation of God, as we have the divine Trinity, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Satan is nothing but a copier, And he is trying to do the same thing. And so he has his trinity of himself, Satan, the beast, whom John calls the Antichrist, and the religious prophet, the false prophet, who assists the Antichrist. So we're going to be looking at the beast from the sea, the beast from the earth, and as always, we want the Holy Spirit to help us in our study.
Yes, Heavenly Father, we thank you and praise you for this opportunity to hear and study your word. We ask, Lord, that you would reveal your truth through Pastor Jerry, Lord, and Lord, you would touch your people, Lord. Help them to understand what he is saying. Bring forth the word just very clear, very direct. Help each person to take what you want them to take away today. We thank you. We praise you. Let all that we do and say glorify you, Lord. In your precious name, amen.
Amen and amen. Let's look at our little booklet of pictures, the Revelation 13, Satanic Trinity. You'll see on the little page I to the left, the timeline that includes the rapture, and we've entitled that The Rapture and the Second Coming. The next prophetic event that we are looking forward to is the rapture, or the catching away of the church. Christ is going to return. He'll be in the air. He will not come to the earth, but he'll be in the air, and he will call the church up to him. And as he does that, we're going to be with him in heaven. And we're going to be having the judgment seat of Christ. We're going to have the marriage supper of the Lamb. And while we're going through that, the earth is going through the 7 years of tribulation. The first 3.5 years you see on that diagram are a false peace, a relative false peace. And then the midpoint, we're going to discuss that today, when the Antichrist declares that he is God. And then the last 3.5 years, known as the Great Tribulation. And at the end of that, the Lord's going to return with us, with his saints, and he's going to defeat his enemies and start the time of the millennium. The next timeline below that shows you much the same. Present church age, rapture, the first 3.5 years, known as the beginning of sorrows, the great tribulation, the last 3.5 years, the return of Christ and you and me and him, the millennium, which lasts for how long? 1,000 years, right? That's what a millennium is. And then the final judgment of all the unrighteous at the white throne judgment. And then the eternal state. We have 16 weeks of this. We did last year, dear. And if you want to go to our website, reachoutfellowship.com, or to YouTube or Facebook, you'll see 16 weeks of the prophetic timeline that Kelly and I did this last year. We thoroughly enjoyed that. The next page to the right, number one, you'll see Jesus as he takes the scroll. The scroll, which is going to reveal the prophetic events taking place in Revelation, the judgments about to take place. First are the seven seals of judgment. You'll see that at the bottom of page one. As the Lord breaks the first seal, the white horse comes forth, indicating deception from the Antichrist. The second seal is broken, and that is the red horse, indicating war. The third seal is broken, and that's the black horse, which is famine. And then the fourth seal is broken, that's the pale horse, pestilence, and a quarter of mankind dies. The fifth seal, martyrdom, and the great tribulation. And the sixth seal then shows heavenly signs, indicating that as we get ready for the seventh seal to be broken, that does not end the agony of the world, it just simply introduces more judgments in the seven trumpets and the seven bowls. And then we see the seven trumpets at the top of page two. We already covered this. Green grass and 1/3 of the trees are burned up. The second trumpet sounds and 2/3 of the sea, and they become blood. 1/3 of the ships and the sea life are destroyed. 1/3 of the waters turn bitter in the third trumpet. The fourth trumpet sounds, and 1/3 of the sun, moon, and stars do not shine. The fifth trumpet sounds. Locusts come forth, demonic spirits with military power. The sixth trumpet sounds, and 200 million man army comes in from Asia in that area. Not hard to imagine when you've got more than 1/3 of the population of the world is probably in India and China alone. The seventh trumpet then sounds, the kingdom of God is declared. And then we have the Satanic Trinity today, which we're going to be talking about. That's Satan, the Antichrist, and the false prophet. And that brings us now to our study today as we look at the Satanic Trinity of what is going to be motivating Satan to try his final attempt to replace Jesus Christ. And he is going to do all that he can. He's going to be, as they would say in poker, he's all in. He tried to destroy Jesus through Herod. He tried to destroy Jesus through Judas. Now his final attempt is going to be through the man of sin, known as the Antichrist, with his assistant, the false prophet. And we're going to see that obviously the work of Satan never, ever will succeed. Amen? So let's begin Revelation 13. And I'm going to ask for Kelly to read the first 10 verses. And this is the beast from the sea, and this is a description of the Antichrist and the revived Roman Empire.
Then I stood on the sand of the sea, and I saw a beast rising up out of the sea, having 7 heads and 10 horns, and on his horns 10 crowns, and on his heads a blasphemous name. Now the beast which I saw was like a leopard, his feet were like the feet of a bear, and his mouth like the mouth of a lion. The dragon gave him his power, his throne, and great authority. And I saw one of his heads as it had been mortally wounded, and his deadly wound was healed. And all the world marveled and followed the beast. So they worshiped the dragon who gave authority to the beast, and they worshiped the beast, saying, "Who is like the beast? Who is able to make war with him?" And he was given a mouth speaking great things and blasphemies, and he was given authority to continue for 42 months. Then he opened his mouth in blasphemy against God, to blaspheme his name, his tabernacle, and those who dwell in heaven. It was granted to him to make war with the saints and to overcome them. And authority was given him over every tribe, tongue, and nation. All who dwell on the earth will worship him, whose names have not been written in the book of life of this Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. If anyone has an ear, let him hear. He who leads into captivity shall go into captivity. He who kills with the sword must be killed with the sword. Here is the patience and the faith of the saints.
So Satan is going to be using this beast from the sea. We're going to talk about him. And he's also going to use his assistant, his religious leader, the beast from the earth. And Kelly's going to read verses 11 through 18 as this completes our reading for today.
Then I saw another beast coming up out of the earth, and he had 2 horns like a lamb and spoke like a dragon. And he exercises all the authority of the first beast in his presence and causes the earth and those who dwell in it to worship the first beast whose deadly wound was healed. He performs great signs so that he even makes fire come down from heaven on the earth in the sight of men. And he deceives those who dwell on the earth by those signs which he was granted to do in the sight of the beast, telling those who dwell on the earth to make an image to the beast who was wounded by the sword and lived. He was granted power to give breath to the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and cause as many as would not worship the image of the beast to be killed. He causes all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and slave, to receive a mark on their right hand or on their foreheads, and that no one may buy or sell except one who has the mark of the name of the beast or the number of his name. Here is wisdom. Let him who has understanding calculate the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man. His number is 666.
That's rather chilling, isn't it? So again, looking at our little booklet of pictures, on page 3 at the top, you'll see the beast from the sea, which is the Antichrist and the revived Roman Empire. At the bottom of that page is the war which he has with the saints. And then on page 4, we see his assistant, the beast from the earth, the lamb with the 2 horns. And at the bottom, you'll see the miracles the lamb is able to perform, bringing down fire from heaven. Top of page 5, you'll see the image of the beast as he sets up an image of himself in the temple in Jerusalem and demands worship. That is the abomination of desolation, the abomination which makes desolate the temple. And that is when the last 3.5 years really kicks into high gear. And that's when Jesus said, whatever you're doing, get out of Jerusalem quickly. And then finally, the number of the beast is 666. So let's talk about this. If you were with us for our study last week, the beast is not unfamiliar to you. But let's go over it again. Verse 1 of chapter 13. John is on the island of Patmos. He has been put there through persecution because of his faith in Jesus Christ. And we don't know if it's Domitian as the Caesar at that time, but he's in hard labor. It was a mining island where they had to dig and chop and whatever. Here's a man in his 90s having to do physical labor like that. Well, I stood on the sand of the sea. And the sea in prophecy always deals with mankind, all of humanity. So here he is, John is standing on the sand of the sea, and I saw a beast rising up out of the sea. So this beast is coming out of humanity. This beast will be the revived Roman Empire with the Antichrist as its head. It will come from the sea, meaning from mankind. He's not going to come from Israel or Jerusalem, that's called the land, but it's going to come from a Gentile power. He's going to have 7 heads. He's going to have 10 horns. And on his horns, 10 crowns. And on his heads, a blasphemous name. Now the beast which I saw was like a leopard. His feet were like the feet of a bear. His mouth like the mouth of a lion. The dragon gave him his power, his throne, and great authority. The dragon is Satan. He's giving this Antichrist and his power everything. Satan has a lot of power. He's really giving it all to this man. So here's this beast, and you saw the picture that we have in the booklet here, many different renderings, and all of this is easily ascertained by the internet. Just go on the internet now, and you'll see different renderings. I like this particular one. Pretty ugly, isn't it? And this is the, you'll see in your outline, this is the identity of the beast, whom John calls the Antichrist. And he is a political world ruler. He's also the little horn in Daniel's prophecy in chapter 7 and verse 8. He is the head of the revived Roman Empire, Daniel 7, verse 7. So let's go back to Daniel in the Old Testament. Daniel had a lot of insight into the future of what's going to be like. And remember now, prophecy is always from the perspective of Israel, not the United States. The United States is not in prophecy, except just part of the world. But it's all about Israel. And Daniel is wanting to know about Israel. And God is telling Daniel that Israel has always been dominated by Gentile powers. Jesus acknowledged this when he said to his disciples just before he had the triumphal entry that Jerusalem's going to be trodden down by the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles is fulfilled. The times of the Gentiles began, and you'll see that here with Egypt. Remember Egypt and bondage and Moses getting them out of Egypt. The next world power which dominated Israel was Assyria, modern-day Iraq. And Assyria took the northern 10 tribes into captivity in 722 BC. The next world Gentile power which dominated Israel was Babylon, with Nebuchadnezzar as its king. And they sacked and destroyed Jerusalem and Judah in 586 BC. Took them into captivity, took Daniel into captivity. So when Daniel's alive, Babylon is the world governing power. He works directly for Nebuchadnezzar. And then Daniel's still alive when Babylon falls. The next Gentile power which comes is the Medo-Persian Empire, Cyrus and Darius. And he sees the actual fall. He's there the night that it falls, the Medo-Persian Empire. Now, after Daniel's time, the next power is going to be Greece. Then Alexander the Great is going to be the young ruler who is able to destroy the great Medo-Persian Empire. He dies quickly, young. He's about 33 years of age. Four generals take over from him and fight each other for world power and domination over Israel. One of them becomes a picture, really, of the future Antichrist, a Syrian general named Antiochus Epiphanes, who actually is the first to desecrate the temple. He takes a pig, sacrifices it to his god in the temple in Jerusalem, infuriates the Jews, and Judas Maccabeus and his sons rise up in rebellion and come against that power. And that is the celebration of Hanukkah, which the Jews celebrate to this day, as God did a miracle, as they tried to consecrate the temple once again, and they only had one day's supply of oil. It takes 7 days to make olive oil. And God took that one day of oil and stretched it for 7 days and made the Hanukkah a major celebration for them. Well, Greece fell to Rome. Rome was the world power during John's time. That's why he's in captivity. All of the other disciples were martyred pretty much by Rome and the testimony of their faith in Christ. But Rome never really was conquered, was it? Germanic tribes came in and hassled them a bit. But Rome was never taken over and destroyed by any other world power. It was destroyed in its political and economic power internally because of its own decadence. Its own decadence and its own profligate living, and it became nothing but a weak power. Rome is no power today politically. It has no power today economically. I didn't mention religiously, did I? It is still powerful religiously. Out of 8 billion people, 1.1 billion people claim to be Roman Catholics. We're not coming against Catholics, not coming against anybody, just talking facts. The Pope and the Roman Catholic Church has power unimaginable. And when the final world church is established after the true church leaves, there's indication it's going to be based in Rome, and perhaps the Roman Catholic system will be part of it, as well as all the other isms. I'm not talking about individual Catholics, whether they're saved or not. I'll say this about you all have Roman Catholic relatives. Here's my quick answer on that one. Roman Catholicism has the seven sacraments. That they believe is necessary for salvation. If a Roman Catholic is relying on the seven sacraments for salvation, that person will not go to heaven. If that person, even in the midst of those seven sacraments, says, I belong to Jesus, he's my Savior, I don't care what they're doing.
Still have to have Jesus.
They're going up. It's all about Jesus. And the same thing for Reach Out, and the same thing for Methodists and Lutherans. And
I've known many Catholics. They're wonderful.
Absolutely.
Priests and, but, you know, there is a weakening. I don't know if you guys have been watching. And kind of, in my opinion, it's not that the church is getting a lot of, like, I have some bishops and things on my Facebook that I'm, you know, kind of friends with from the Catholic Church. And they're so angry over the things that the Pope is doing. So you can see the weakening within even the Catholic Church, what's going on now, and you wonder if this is what's, you know, coming down the road. I don't know, but it's very interesting to watch, at least.
So the Roman Empire never has ended. The Roman Empire is still very strong in the Church, and the revived Roman Empire, it's going to be revived again, is going to come in the last times, and that's the beast that he sees. And the 10 horns are going to be 10 kings of 10 countries in the old Roman Empire. Just get on your computer and Google the old Roman Empire, and it will color on the map what Rome conquered. And Rome conquered the countries around the Mediterranean. From the, not to Ireland, to Sicily, you were safe there, but if you're from Great Britain, hard cheese there, you are part of the old Roman Empire. Great Britain, all the way down to Spain, Italy, Yugoslavia, Greece, over to Israel, along the northern border of Africa, Libya, and etc. That is part of the old Roman Empire. 10 kings will arise from that area. One king is going to be a king or a leader of one nation. He will conquer three other nations in that 10. Then he'll conquer all of the 10. And that 10-nation confederation is the revived Roman Empire. That's the beast. That's his power base. He then moves and gets power over the one world church. We're going to see that in Revelation 17.
Yeah, they're going to come against that church.
That's right. And so the true church is in heaven.
Right.
The one world church is going to lift this man up, and this man is then going to take them over. The church will be there to lift him up, and then he'll take over the church. He now has the power religiously through the false prophet who will run the religious system. He will then have the power politically. He'll have the power economically. He's the man. And he will say, in order to buy and sell, you need to have my mark on your forehead or on your hand, 666. You won't be able to buy or sell. Kelly was working at a hospital yesterday. She mentioned that. She did not have her debit card with her. She had cash. She could not buy a cup of coffee. In that hospital here, in this area, you cannot use your cash to buy anything in that hospital. It's only the beginning.
And it's only the beginning. This is just the beginning, what's coming down. You look at it like, well, of course, nobody wants to steal money, right? Right? You know, use that. But they probably don't know, right? It's just slowly incorporating into everything.
So then you're going to have the mark, 666, or you don't get a cup of coffee in a hospital, you don't get a house, you don't get
money. By the way, there'll be a social credit score, and what will happen is, I listen to these doctors from Europe, there'll be a social credit score, and if you're hanging out with someone who's saying something about the government, it's going to come up, and they're going to know on your social credit score, and then people are going to say, I'm not going to want to even talk to you because you're going to bring me down. That's a whole nother, it's going to be a scary time. Scary time.
Hey, it's going on right now. Reach Out is broadcast on reachoutfellowship.com. Yes. YouTube, yes. Facebook, maybe yes, maybe no. We just got out of jail again. Kelly's been in jail and Facebook for the last twice now she's been in jail. The last one was for 21 days. So you can watch Reach Out on Facebook, dear heart, and then suddenly you can't watch us for 21 days because she said something which offended their sense of right and wrong, whether it was political or medical or what have you. And we're going to see more and more and more of that. And there's a case in front of the Supreme Court right now this week, the Biden administration talking about the social media, and the question is, how much power does the government have to control social media for the expression of free speech? So, when I was a kid, I was naively taught in school that the United States of America proposes and has free speech. Well, that and other myths. That's like the unicorn that I'm still looking for. Free speech? Well, let's not get into that. That's another topic. Let's go back to what Daniel saw. He saw this around 539 BC, and this is the beast that he saw in chapter 7 of Daniel. He has the vision of the four beasts. I'm going to ask Kelly to pick it up with verse 1 of Daniel chapter 7.
In the first year of Belshazzar, king of Babylon, Daniel had a dream and visions of his head while on his bed. Then he wrote down the dream, telling the main facts. Daniel spoke, saying, I saw in my vision by night, and behold, the four winds of heaven were stirring up the great sea. And the four great beasts came up from the sea, each different from the other.
So again, the great sea is mankind, not the Mediterranean. It's mankind. These are beasts that are world-governing powers that will govern Israel and the world.
The first was like a lion and had eagle's wings.
So Daniel is now seeing prophecy from his day going back. And who is the world power in Daniel's day with the world leader? Babylon, Nebuchadnezzar. So they're going to see that's the lion here.
I watched till its wings were plucked off, and it was lifted up from the earth and made to stand on 2 feet like a man.
Nebuchadnezzar.
And a man's heart was given to it. And suddenly another beast, a second, like a bear. It was raised up on one side and had three ribs in its mouth between its teeth. And they said thus to it, arise, devour much flesh.
So the power that overcame Babylon was the Medo-Persian Empire. It was like a bear, slow-moving, powerful, and raised up on one side because one of those kingdoms was more powerful than the other. The Persians were more powerful than the Medes, and it had three ribs in its mouth. Those are three nations that it conquered, and it had powerful teeth. It's devouring, and now the country, the world power that replaces that, verse 6.
After this I looked, and there was another like a leopard, which had on its back four wings of a bird. The beast also had four heads, and dominion was given to it.
So the leopards are lightning fast, and Alexander the Great was lightning fast, died early, about age 32 or 33, as I said, and four wings of a bird, those are the four generals who took over from him and argued over territory, including the general in Syria and the one in Egypt, Ptolemy, back and forth. Verse 7, and here's the beast.
After this I saw in the night visions, and behold, a fourth beast, dreadful and terrible, exceedingly strong. It had huge iron teeth. It was devouring, breaking in pieces, and trampling the residue with its feet. It was different from all the beasts that were before it, and it had 10 horns.
So this beast is much more powerful than the others, slow-moving, prodding, iron teeth, breaking everything in its path, and it has 10 horns. Those are your 10 kings from 10 different nations in the Roman Empire, that old Roman Empire. Verse 8.
I was considering the horns, and there was another horn, a little one, coming up among them, before whom three of the first horns were plucked out by the roots. And there in this horn were eyes like the eyes of a man, and a mouth speaking pompous words.
And so there's your Antichrist. He comes up out of the old Roman Empire. He replaces three other kings, and he is filled with blasphemy. The Ancient of Days sets up the throne, beginning in verse 9. The explanation of the beast is explained. And let's pick it up with verse 23.
Thus he said, the fourth beast shall be a fourth kingdom on earth, which shall be different from all other kingdoms, and shall devour the whole earth, trample it, and break it in pieces. The 10 horns are 10 kings who shall arise from this kingdom, and another shall arise after them. He shall be different from the first ones, and shall subdue three kings. He shall speak pompous words against the Most High, shall persecute the saints of the Most High, and shall intend to change times and law. Then the saints shall be given into his hand for a time and times and a half a time.
So clearly there you see the fourth beast is made up of the 10 kings, and one king replaces them. That's the Antichrist. He speaks pompous words. He tries to change the laws, the times. He sets up his own laws. He becomes the law. And the saints are given into his hand. He's going to be able to have great authority over believers, and it'll be for 3.5 years. A time is 1 year, times is 2 years, and a half a time is a half a year. But, and here's the good news, verse 26.
But the court shall be seated, and they shall take away his dominion, to consume and destroy it forever. Then the kingdom and dominion and the greatness of the kingdoms under the whole heaven shall be given to the people, the saints of the Most High. His kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and all dominions shall serve him and obey him.
So let's look now at this Antichrist and hear what Paul has to say to the Thessalonian church. In 2 Thessalonians, the question is arising about the rapture and the timing and the church and what's going to go on. Is the church going to go through the rapture, the tribulation, or not? The answer is clearly not. The church will not go through this punishment, because the tribulation is the punishment by Jesus Christ on a Christ-rejecting world. He will not punish his children who are not rejecting him, obviously. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse 1, the Apostle Paul writes,
Now, brethren, concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our gathering together to him.
Concerning the rapture, when we are gathered up to him.
We ask you, not to be soon shaken in mind or troubled, either by spirit or by word or by letter, as if from us, as though the day of Christ had come.
They were told that Jesus Christ had already come. Can you imagine how you'd feel? And you say, hey, I got good news and bad news. Jesus did come. That's the good news. The bad news is he came last week, and you and I are still here. Whoa, that means that we are not his, and we're not caught up with him. That's how they felt. Paul said, no, that's not the case. He has not come yet. This is what's going to happen when he does come.
Let no one deceive you by any means, for that day will not come unless the falling away comes first, and the man of sin is revealed, the son of perdition.
So that day is not going to come until there's been a falling away, and the man of sin is revealed. Then you're going to know that the rapture has taken place at that point. Verse 4, this talks about this Antichrist. Verse 4.
Who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he sits as God in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God.
There's your abomination of desolation.
Do you not remember that when I was still with you, I told you these things? And now you know what is restraining, that he may be revealed in his own time.
So the Antichrist has not yet been revealed because there is a restraining going on. There's a restraining of sin at this point and a restraining of evil to the point where he is not yet revealed. And here's the timing, verse 7.
For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. Only he who now restrains will do so until he is taken out of the way.
So there's already a mystery of lawlessness. There's already that climate for Satan to operate under his control. The Antichrist spirit is with us, if you will. The Antichrist is not yet here. It's already at work, even in John's time. Notice the capital H. Only he, capital H, who now restrains, will do so until he, capital H, is taken out of the way. He is God, the Holy Spirit. He is restraining. He'll be taken out of the way. When? At the rapture. Does that mean the Holy Spirit's no longer here on earth? The Holy Spirit is God. He's omnipresent. He's everywhere. But in his restraining of evil ministry, working through the church, when the church goes up, the Holy Spirit with his indwelling presence and power no longer is working through the church. The church is now in heaven, and the restraining has been removed. Now the Antichrist and the devil can have their way through the tribulation as Jesus brings forth judgment. Notice my mother used to say, non-theologically, let it all hang out. And that's what's going to happen here. Let it all hang out. Is the Holy Spirit still here during the tribulation? Of course he is. He's God. What is he doing? He's not restraining evil, per se, through the church. What he's doing is he's working on the heart. He is convicting, as Jesus said, of sin, righteousness, and judgment, even as he does now. He'll bring people to Christ. He'll still continue to work, but now the Antichrist is free to do his own thing, verse 8, and the devil's thing.
And then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord will consume with the breath of his mouth and destroy with the brightness of his coming.
That's Satan. The Antichrist only really has 7 years to operate, and especially the last 3.5 years.
The coming of the lawless one is according to the working of Satan with all power, signs, and lying wonders.
We're going to see that he's going to have tremendous power, signs, lying wonders.
And with all unrighteous deception among those who perish, because they did not receive the love of the truth that they might be saved.
So those who have deliberately refused the love of the truth,
nope, not
and
gonna
salvation
believe it,
are going to be deceived by the devil, and making it even, nope, worse, look at what happens in verse 11.
And for this reason, reminds me of when, before I say it, it reminds me of when the people were suffering and Moses' time, and they sent delusions, and this is the same thing that's going to happen. And for this reason, God will send them strong delusion that they should believe the lie, that they all may be condemned who did not believe the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness.
So those who have rejected the truth, have pleasure in unrighteousness, will be deceived by the devil, by the Antichrist and his miracles, and God will affirm that deception. So don't think that because you go up, your nearby friend says, oop, I see that person
I'm
went
so
up,
sorry,
must be Christ, I now come to Christ. That's not faith by hearing, that's by sight. And faith is always in the heart. Faith is the only way to get saved.
And God did that with Moses, remember,
that's
with
right,
the people?
That's
he
right,
affirmed it to Pharaoh, that right, he said, let my people go. And then he turned, the Bible says he turned his heart even more because he was stubborn, I'll give you even more.
That's right.
And that's kind of what he does here.
So now, chapter 13 unfolds very quickly, very easily. You're all experts on this. Let's go back and look at verse 1. I stood on the sand of the sea, meaning all of humanity, over 8 billion people. I saw a beast rising out of the sea. That's the revived Roman Empire of those 10 nations. having seven heads and 10 horns. That means the seven heads were it was the culmination of all the world dominating powers of the Gentiles over the years, and the 10 horns, the 10 contemporaneous kings with the Antichrist, and on his heads a blasphemous name. Now the beast which I saw was like a leopard, that's Greece, his background, feet like the bear, that's Medo-Persia, mouth like the lion, that's Babylon. The dragon gave him his power, his throne, his great authority. Here's an interesting fact, verse 3, Kelly's going to read that.
And I saw one of his heads as it had been mortally wounded, and his deadly wound was healed, and all the world marveled and followed the beast.
So there'll apparently be an assassination attempt on the Antichrist. There was an assassination attempt on Abraham Lincoln. Was it successful? Of course it was. There was an assassination attempt on Ronald Reagan. Was it successful? No, it was not. This will be an attempt of assassination on the Antichrist, and he is going to be healed, and the world's going to marvel and say, this man is very, very special. And so the devil is going to somehow use that wound to lift up the prominence of this man. Let's go on in verse 4.
So they worshiped the dragon who gave authority to the beast, and they worshiped the beast, saying, who is like the beast? Who is able to make war with him?
So they are so enamored of the beast and the power of Satan, they're saying, we're worshiping Satan, we're worshiping the beast. Nobody can stand against him. He's absolutely all-powerful. Again, God is giving him this power. He's doing it even right now because Jesus calls Satan the god of this age. Paul calls him the prince of the power of the air, under God's permissive authority. And that's going to stop once the Lord returns in the millennium. He is then going to rule not through grace, but through a rod of iron. And he's going to use you and me to enforce that rule. All right, and he goes on to say in verse 5 about the Antichrist.
And he was given a mouth speaking great things and blasphemies. And he was given authority to continue for 42 months.
42 months is 3.5 years.
Then he opened his mouth in blasphemy against God, to blaspheme his name, his tabernacle, and those who dwell in heaven.
He'll be speaking against God the way political candidates speak against each other in their campaigns.
Have you ever heard him? He knows, I know someone who used to speak against God every time he blames. It was so bad that I would comb my ears. They would speak against God, blaspheme in people in heaven. That's what you're going to say. Wicked.
Joe, I look forward to seeing you in heaven. Joe was my maintenance handyman at the church in the house. Love Joe, nicest guy in the world. And it's not confidential. Joe Donahue, was it? And he would just blaspheme God. He had a wife. He divorced. They divorced. She remarried, and the next husband stabbed her to death. And because of that, Joe hated God. Where were you? Why didn't you protect my wife? He would blaspheme God. He'd get on social media, Facebook. He had a daughter who came to our church, and
for a long
she
time,
loved the Lord.
Nicole.
And he would blaspheme God like you cannot believe. But he was very social. The Lord just said, back off, love him, and don't try to proselytize. He knows where you stand. And this went on for years. Joe did a lot of work around this church. You'll see his handiwork here. But he just blasphemed God like you cannot believe. And then one day, I just least expected it. I was downstairs doing a radio program. Joe comes in. Hi, Joe, what's up? He says, I want to give my heart to Christ. What's going on? He says, I'm so sorry. What I've done was wrong. It was sinful. Christ is my Savior.
Total true story.
I said, let's pray the sinner's prayer. He had hands like baseball gloves. And I said, let's pray. And he prayed, gave his heart to the Lord with such sincerity, patted him on the back and said, see ya. And off he went. It wasn't 2 weeks later, I got a call from Nicole.
Not kidding.
And he went home, he just sat down, apparently had a meal, had his puppy right next to him, sat down to watch television. He was here, and then he was not. And that was it. That was Joe. So blaspheming, but there are people who blaspheme him today. If you're blaspheming God, or if you and I are, stop it. Give your heart to Jesus.
And look at how God took him. And, you know, that's amazing. And Nicole came to our church for years. I don't know where she is now, but she was involved in the domestic violence program, big deal in Albany. And she used to do
because
all
kinds of her mother, yep.
Because of her mom. But she was really touched. She paid for his whole funeral.
The church did, yeah.
The church did. It was a blessing. Yeah. But my point is, that was, you never know who you're ministering to. Sometimes the most wicked situations, he wasn't really a wicked guy, what he was doing was wicked. Of course, we're all wicked, right, without Jesus. But And then he gave his heart to the Lord, and look, that was it. God took him out. So,
my guess is if you come across somebody who's blaspheming God, there was a time when a loved one died or something horrible happened in that family. They prayed that it would not happen, and it did happen, and they blame
God. People get angry.
God becomes the scapegoat. And that's almost always the reason. I never had anybody say, I just hate God for no reason at all. I just happen to hate him. No, they hate him for a reason. He wasn't there, they think, when he should have been. And that's always the common denominator. So let God work through you to minister in that situation. Let's get on with our study. Verse 7, here he is being given great power by, is it the Antichrist again? Mm-hmm.
It was granted to him to make war with the saints and to overcome them. And authority was given him over every tribe, tongue, and nation.
Worldwide power.
All who dwell on the earth will worship him whose names have not been written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world.
Now, I went through about 12 Bibles yesterday on this here. They're evenly divided. Either way it works regarding a phrase. All who dwell on the earth will worship him. That's obvious. And who's going to worship him? Those whose names have not been written in the book of life of the Lamb. So the Lamb is, this is the book of salvation. If you're saved, your name is written in the book of the Lamb, slain from the foundation of the world. And the idea here is that if you are not in the book of life of the Lamb, Jesus, who was slain from the foundation of the world, you won't be saved. The other half of the translations have it a little bit differently. They both work. But there it is, whose names have not been written in the book of life of the Lamb, who was slain from the foundation of the world. Or putting it more succinctly, whose names have not been written in the book of life from the foundation of the world. Of the Lamb who was slain. So was Jesus slain from the foundation of the world? No, it was in God's mind, but the book of life was there. And the interesting scripture, which I think I want to give you, this one blew me away as Kelly and I taught on this some time ago. I did my doctoral thesis on Ephesians, I love it, but this escaped me until this time of teaching. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 4, this is so exciting.
Just as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love.
That's so powerful. Read it again, honey.
Just as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. Having predestined us to adoption as sons by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will. To the praise of the glory of his grace, by which he made us accepted in the beloved.
So God determined to save me the day I gave my heart to Christ in 1978? No. The day I was born, too many years ago to count? No. God chose me for salvation before the foundation of the world. So, a Bible written chronologically for verse 1 should not begin with, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Verse 1, in the beginning, God determined to save Jerry Lynn. Verse 2, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, etc., etc. He chose you before he created the heavens and the earth. And he chose you through the Lamb who was slain. So
it's a mystery. And the Word of God says that we will not understand all the mysteries. Some things are reserved for God to understand. So don't try to figure it all out.
So the book of life of the Lamb who was slain has the names of those whose names were written in there before the foundation of the world. Talk about security. You're going to lose your salvation? I don't think so. In fact, I know
that's
so.
That's one for predestination.
Yep. All right, verse 9.
If anyone has an ear, let him hear. He who leads into captivity shall go into captivity. He who kills with the sword must be killed with the sword. Here is the patience and the faith of the saints.
Right, so there's a verse of what goes around comes around. It's going to happen to you.
Whoa.
Now, he needs an assistant. He needs somebody who is going to be the religious leader there to support him. Like the president has a vice president. Well, here is the assistant to the beast. This is the beast from the earth, not the beast from the sea, mankind, worldwide power. This is his assistant, verse 11.
Then I saw another beast coming up out of the earth, and he had two horns like a lamb and spoke like a dragon.
So earth would indicate more limited than the sea, but he's there to assist him. He has two horns like a lamb. He looks like the lamb. He looks like Jesus, but he's got the horns of the devil. Okay? And he spoke like the devil, the dragon himself.
And he exercises all the authority of the first beast in his presence and causes the earth and those who dwell in it to worship the first beast whose deadly wound was healed.
So he has all the power that the Antichrist has because that power is coming from the devil. The devil is investing his authority and power in both the Antichrist and the assistant.
He performs great signs so that he even makes fire come down from heaven on the earth in the sight of men.
So he's going to have a lot of power, even as Satan demonstrated power in the account of Moses before Pharaoh. Remember all the miracles that took place? And so this this beast from the earth will also have that kind of power.
And he deceives those who dwell on the earth by those signs which he was granted to do in the sight of the beast, telling those who dwell on the earth to make an image to the beast who was wounded by the sword and lived.
So again, they keep mentioning that the testimony. That's going to be a real plus on the curriculum vitae, on the resume of the Antichrist. I was wounded, and yet I lived. I survived. And that's going to keep coming up. And again, you can worship this man. He is he's of the devil, and we worship the devil.
And
we
by
worship
the
him.
Way, the Jews are looking, I see it all the time, they're looking for their Mashiach, right? They're looking for that man that's going to be the ruler and bring peace. Right. So it's going to be a perfect setup for those who are left behind.
That's right. And in those 3.5 years, they're going to believe him. He's going to give permission to them to build their temple. Ezekiel 38 and 39 play into this as the forces from the north, modern-day Russia and Ukraine and other nations are going to come down against Israel, and the Antichrist and the European forces will be fighting them, backing them off, and he'll take the credit for it, and they're going to say, this is our Savior. But then he walks into the temple, that image of the beast is set up, and it begins to speak and say, in a sense, worship the Antichrist. And so this is the abomination of desolation that Daniel talks about. Jesus talks about it and says, when that happens, flee. Pray that you're not pregnant. Pray that it's not the Sabbath when you can only travel 3/4 of a mile. Flee. Get out of town. He's going to try to persecute all of the Jews who will not accept him and worship him. Well, he's got tremendous power, verse 15.
He was granted power to give breath to the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and cause as many as would not worship the image of the beast to be killed.
So is it far-fetched to think of an image right now that can speak? I mean, we know about robots, we know about AI, we know all that kind of thing here. You don't believe in that? I've got a little girlfriend here. My wife doesn't know it here, but I got a sweet little girlfriend and I can talk to her. And her name is what? Siri, exactly. And so.
Either way, AI, you know, I'm out in the world and I'm hearing stories all the time, and so some of you are. If you're working out in the world, especially in healthcare, I'm learning, and academia, AI is unbelievable. The people, the degrees, the things that are happening, it's blowing my mind with this AI. And I really think this is all going to play into it, the
AI. No question. And so here he goes on to say, verse 16.
He causes all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and slave, to receive a mark on their right hand or on their foreheads, and that no one may buy or sell except one who has the mark or the name of the beast or the number of his name. Here is wisdom. Let him who has understanding calculate the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man. His number is 666.
So those who are alive at that time will be able to tell who the Antichrist is. And the way they're going to do it is by being able to calculate the name. If it's in Hebrew, each letter of the Hebrew alphabet has a certain numerical value, and they'll take the letters of that man's name, I'm assuming it's a man, and they will calculate it, and they will take the numerical equivalence of that name, those letters, and it's going to add up to be 666.
And they're very into numbers, the Jews. You know, I just want to say something before you finish, Pastor. Be grateful you are here. For you, you know, you wonder, well, where am I in this? Where am I in this history? What am I doing in this little place, in this journey? You have a spot, and your spot, you are here. People say, why was I born at this time? This is terrible, what's going on? We are here. God chose us from the foundation of the earth to be born right now, to be here where we are, for those children to be born. We all have a job to play. We have a ministering, we have an area. Whatever we're doing, praying, praising, loving the Lord, being an example, giving the word, we're saved and fear not. Jesus wants you to know, fear not. Keep walking it out. For an instant, you're going to be gone, present with the Lord. A lot of times I think to myself, oh my God, another one died. Oh, I'm so upset. But you know what? They're with Jesus if they knew Jesus. Build your faith. This is the time for us to build our faith and lead as many people to Christ as we can now.
Amen. And the last word about the number 666, what does it mean as far as why 666? The number 7 is the number of what? Completion and perfection. Number of 6 is the number of humanity or created beings. It's one less than God. And so 666 speaks of Satan, Antichrist, false prophet, the satanic trio. They are created beings. They are less than God. We worship and are safe in 777. That is the divine Trinity, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Let's pray.
Amazing. That's a great word. So fear not. Father, we thank you and praise you for this word. And Lord, as we look to the future, we see around us day to day how things are changing. Help your people not to be afraid. Help them to be bold for you, Lord, because we know there's great rewards, Lord. And even though we will cast those crowns at your feet, Lord, we know the rewards are great. We do reap what we sow. Help us, Lord, to be strong for you. Bless your people now. Lord, strengthen them. For those, Lord, who have lost loved ones, help them to be encouraged. It's only in a small amount of time, and you're going to be absent from here, present with the Lord and with your loved ones. So fear not. Continue to do what you're doing. You're doing a great job for Jesus. We love you, Lord. We praise you, and we give you all the glory and honor. Bless your people this day, Lord. Thank you, Father. Amen.
Amen and amen. Well, we're going to close with another favorite hymn of Palm Sunday, All Glory, Lord and Honor. And would you please stand?
Amen.
Sunday and Resurrection Sunday. It's a great time of the year. Let me get the little after music set up for you, dear, and we'll give you the final word.
And now from the book of Philippians, Philippians 4, verse 19 to 20. And my God shall supply all your need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Now to our God and Father be glory forever and ever. In Jesus' name, amen. Shalom, shalom.
God bless you. Have a wonderful week. Shalom.